To my brother. May I begin by wishing you the happiest of birthdays. I'm sure you'll be celebrating your 21 years in your own unique fashion. Please accept this message as a makeshift birthday card. If you, like me, believe it's the thought that counts, then know that I have spent quite a considerable amount of time thinking about what follows. And I believe the conclusions I've arrived at are clearer than they ever have been. This milestone in your life has come very fast, and as the ticking clock of time turns yet another hand, tradition suggests this day marks the culmination of your youth and the beginning of your manhood. Yet manhood is not linked to any number. It is nothing more than a state of mind brought about by a loss of ignorance. This loss is commonly and mistakenly associated with an ending to childlike fun and frivolous behaviour. However, I believe this process of awakening to be vital in allowing a person to truly enjoy and appreciate their time. A life unknowing in the shade, whilst keeping you from being burned, means you never get to see the glorious face of the sun and gaze into the very eyes that allow you to be. A person's age holds little real significance. Despite the extra 36 months my body has spent on this planet, I see you and I as the same age, just as I do my older friends. It's a person's experiences, and most importantly, their mindset and energy, that differentiates them from another, not their seconds spent breathing. This promotion of qualitative over quantitative time means that I no longer wish for a long life. Instead, I wish for a good life, a life put to good use. I would rather be ashes than dust. I would rather that my spark should burn out in a brilliant blaze than it should be stifled by dry rot. I would rather be a superb meteor, every atom of me in magnificent glow, than a sleepy and permanent planet. The function of man is to live, not to exist. I shall not waste my days trying to prolong them. I shall use my time. Until recently, the dream for me had always been to make the most of my time. I believed the only way to achieve that was to find a way of making one's day-to-day activities of the ultimate value. With this in mind, I searched for a day job that I was truly passionate about, as after sleep, there's nothing the average person will spend more time doing than working. This led me to leaving behind jobs that others might not have in the search for this elusive position. Only now have I realized that this position doesn't exist. There is no one job that will quash my constant soul searching. There will never be one activity that will ease my conscience and placate me into trading away my constantly dwindling hours. It is the mindset that must be shifted. This is the journey that I now find myself on, and already it's been more rewarding than any of my previous quests for answers. The mistake I made was trying to find a fulfilling way to operate within the status quo. As I mentioned earlier, the average person spends a lot of their life working, so I searched for a great job. But why should I use the average person as a yardstick? I made the mistake of accepting a way of life just because the majority surrounding me had done so. Aligning yourself with the norm purely because it is the norm is so very wrong. The majority aren't always right, and most importantly, many of them aren't at peace. They just believe that they are less unhappy than they would be in another mode of life. That way of thinking doesn't work for everyone though, and it doesn't work for me. If we ask this majority which they would rather be, a sheep or a wolf, what do you think they would answer? Most would rather be a wolf, but think about what the wolf stands for and what the sheep represents, and you'll realise that the majority are sheep, and that is the very reason they crave the life of a wolf. The wolf is free to live by his own rules, to take his own path. The sheep does not hate the wolf, the sheep fears the wolf because he represents everything that he will never be. The wolf may hunt the sheep, but that does not make him bad. The only evil here comes in the shape of a third character, the shepherd. The shepherds hate the wolves because they disturb their sheep and disrupt their flock. The shepherd wants to kill the wolf. The shepherds are the murderers, not the wolves. The wolves are just doing what they were made to do. The shepherds have no need to kill the wolf, but they do so because the wolf threatens their power, their bind over their brainwashed followers. The wolf has no need or desire for power, only a will to live. If we had no shepherds, we would have no sheep, only wild wolves roaming free. Unfortunately, we live in a world where the way of the wolf is being extinguished, and the more powerful the shepherds become, the more sheep we get. You may find that overcoming this majority way of thinking is no easy task. Whenever you start to think differently, you'll be drawn back in by some seemingly infallible proof that the way the world lives now is right. This is an idea that is maintained and supported by the shepherds. You have a choice to make. Commit to the way you've been engineered to think and spend your life trying to become a shepherd leading other sheep, or free yourself from an unhealthy fascination with labels, titles, and reputation by breaking rank and remembering your wild, natural ways. It is the hour to be drunken, to escape being the martyred slaves of time, be ceaselessly drunk on wine, on poetry, or on virtue, as you wish. Don't be defined by your success and whether or not you achieve your goals. By all means, set goals and try your utmost to reach them, but when you start to attach your identity to them, you start to lose the real you, your true inner self. If you spend your life attaching yourself to one target, what happens when you hit it? A friend of mine who's found great success at a still relatively young age once said to me, "When I think about my life, I realise that I've already achieved everything I ever wanted, but nothing's changed. I still feel the same." To live only for some future goal is shallow. It's the sides of the mountain which sustain life, not the top. Here's where things grow. Equally, don't be driven by a need to defeat others. There's an important distinction between winning and beating opponents that is all too often forgot. Someone who finds motivation from outdoing his contemporaries will never truly find peace. He needs to go deep into himself and ask why he craves this egotistical and ultimately empty victory. The only things you should want to defeat are your inner demons. Your biggest rival is and will always be you. When you start to prioritise the external side of triumph, i.e. how your victory or achievement looks to others, then you start to attach yourself too readily to your ego. Your ego is a powerful and dangerous tool, but it should be just that, a tool to be used when necessary. When nervous about a challenge that puts you out of your comfort zone, or when dwelling too long on the prospect of potential embarrassment, these are the moments to use your ego to give yourself that kickstart you need. However, when your ego defines who you are and how others see you becomes more important to you than how you see yourself, this is where the ego has taken over. The ego climber is like an instrument that's out of adjustment. He puts his foot down an instant too soon or too late. He's likely to miss a beautiful passage of sunlight through the trees. When he talks, his talk is forever about somewhere else. He's here, but he's not here. He rejects the here. He's unhappy with it, wants to be farther up the trail. But when he gets there, will be just as unhappy because then it will be here. What he's looking for, what he wants, is all around him. But he doesn't want that because it is all around him. Every step's an effort, both physically and spiritually, because he imagines his goal to be external and distant. The secret is to enjoy the journey and realize that the journey is all there ever is. There is no then, only now. When sitting in the back of a car on some long, seemingly never-ending trip, don't fidget uncontrollably with your eyes fixed firmly on the road ahead, constantly questioning when you'll arrive at your destination. Look out the window and to the landscape you constantly cross. Yes, you're on your way somewhere, but the physical transportation of your body across land at speed is no more than a literal representation of your entire life. The trick is not to find a way to get there faster. The trick is to find a way of enjoying the ride. If you then become excessively focused on the goal, the now is no longer honoured. It becomes reduced to a mere stepping stone to the future, with no intrinsic value. Your life's journey is no longer an adventure, just an obsessive need to arrive, to attain, to make it. You no longer see or smell the flowers by the wayside either, nor are you aware of the beauty and the miracle of life that unfolds all around you when you are present in the now. Ultimately, what I'm trying to put across is that you shouldn't restrict yourself from fully living by centering your existence around some wish for material success. And by material, I mean anything physical or tangible. The most common deathbed regret is that the soon-to-be deceased wishes they'd spent less time working. We can't take anything physical with us. The armoury we need for our journey beyond mortal existence is made up entirely of energy. Energy that reflects the way we lived our life, the positive effect we had on the world we inhabited, and those we shared it with. What difference does it make after all? Anonymity in the world of men is better than fame in heaven. For what's heaven? What's earth? All in the mind. You will never be ready to stop living. Likewise, you should never want to. However, when the situation is forced upon you, you can either tackle it head on and ultimately overcome it, or you can be dragged away kicking and screaming, just the way you entered this domain. Whether you are content and at peace when your time comes is a decision you must make. One that will be made by a lifetime of small choices. Defeating death is an option available to everyone, and through our actions, we will, subconsciously or consciously, either take or decline this opportunity. The secret of life is to die before you die and find that there is no death. Possessing the right mentality will not only help you face death, but all the seemingly smaller challenges in life. The best advice I ever received for tackling feelings of nervousness or trepidation, emotions that we're all subjected to at some point or another, is to remember just how utterly insignificant what you're about to do is. On the large scale of things, not only globally, but universally, what you're about to do, no matter who you are or what it is indescribably insignificant. Dwelling on this thought in the wrong way can turn it into a negative energy. But instead, truly listening to these words should allow you to be fully free. Free from frets of emotional pain, free to do as you want to, free to live as you were made to. It is the thing's very insignificance that makes it worthwhile. Because, in the words of Gandhi, whatever you do will be insignificant. But it is very important that you do it. I found one of the best parallels for life in the form of the computer game Football Manager. The game is renowned among football fans for being highly addictive and all-consuming. I personally have lost months to this game. When in the midst of a Football Manager career and engrossed in the everyday running of an entirely fictional football club, it is one of the most important things to you in your life. And you find it almost shocking that friends and family don't find it anywhere near as interesting. Why wouldn't they care that you just managed to sign Wayne Rooney on a free transfer? That was a bargain! But alas, they too are in the midst of their very own unique experience, and as a result, never care as much about yours as you do. It's not like managing a real team or being part of a real life shared experience. This is completely and wholly your own fantasy world in which no other being exists. Yet, despite this, you spend countless moments deliberating over small, inconsequential decisions in the hope of achieving a completely imaginary success. But who is to say it doesn't matter if it matters to you? I'm not saying that it's fine to spend months on end playing computer games. The point I'm trying to make is that the journey you take on your Football Manager career is not that different from the journey of your life. No matter how successful you are or how long you spend at it, eventually your career will come to an end. You may get sacked, you might get bored, or your game may just stop working. Whatever the cause, the moment you start, the only certainty is that it will come to an end. The question is, with that knowledge, how you decide to approach it. Do you accept your fate and never truly embrace the experience? Or do you decide that despite the fact that time will eventually overtake you, despite the fact that you are destined to be lost in a sea of former managers, you will give it your all, you will seize the opportunity you've been handed, and you will be the best manager you can be. At least then you'll know that whenever your time comes, you did all you could, you gave all you had to give. He was justifying his existence, than which life can do no greater, for life achieves its summit when it does to the uttermost that which it was equipped to do. When discussing at length my own concerns about the human condition with someone very close to me, he advised that the load I carry in my head with me everywhere I go might be lessened by welcoming religion into my life. To this I would say that whilst I'm not opposed to religion in any way, I am against fundamentalism and out-of-date, inflexible dogmas. I currently find myself interested in Buddhism and several aspects of Hinduism, but am in no place to call myself an authority on such topics. I think when it comes to matters of theology, the key is to dip in and out of what is available, find what works for you, and take that with you. To be completely without faith is to lose all hope, but to be blinded by it is just as bad. I guess Abraham Lincoln said it best when asked if he was a religious man, he replied, "When I do good, I feel good. When I do bad, I feel bad. That is my religion." Before I finish, I would like to spend a moment addressing why I felt the need to discuss this with you, and why I, of all people, am in any place to share such thoughts. The first thing to say is that I am not an authority on anything other than my own sidewinding sojourn through the tall grass fields of life. In fact, it was not long ago that I would have said I have nothing to offer anybody except my own confusion. However, as the clouds of doubt that linger in my head have started to disperse, I felt an urge to put down in words what was in my mind. What I have detailed here are thoughts that have applied and appealed to me, thoughts that will not necessarily resonate with you or anyone else in the same way. I share these sentiments in the hope that somewhere within my long-winded soliloquy, there may be something, no matter how small or something, that helps to solve a question posed by the constantly muttering inner monologue all too many of us suffer from. For me, peace of mind is the silencing of that voice, and therefore, that is what I now seek. Peace of mind produces right values. Right values produce right thoughts. Right thoughts produce right actions, and right actions produce work which will be a material reflection for others to see of the serenity at the centre of it all. The next step for me is to carry on with my ascent into the mountains of my own consciousness whilst taking time to enjoy the way up. There is no saying I will ever reach the top, if there is a top at all, but where I've climbed to so far is high enough that I can be satisfied in the knowledge of just that. When no questioning and second guessing is required, that is when you know the path before you is the one to take. When all other paths disappear, that is when you know.